sort of thing that trips off your tongue. But it's an accurate description as engineers would have it. As I've just revealed, I'm a journey by birth and by reputation. This talk, when it first came to life, was called How the Northeast Led the World of Electricity. I knew you would laugh, because people in engineering and meetings like this claim the first in just about everything there is. But in this case, you will see that it's true. So I'm going to start with the Northeast and see how we develop into the grid system. Well, there had to be a number of issues which came together. The first was that the steam turbine, as we understood it then and understand it today, was invented on Tyneside by this gentleman here, who opened a factory to manufacture steam turbines, which were the most efficient form of thermal generation, much more so than the reciprocating engines which were being used at the turn of that century. So you had somebody who knew what the basic ingredient of a new form of generation was. And that's his first turbine in 1891. And that was about 8 years before turbines bigger than that were incorporated in the system in the Northeast. And I will come on to that in more detail. It's still preserved in the Museum of Science on Tyneside. And you can, it's a pity that there's not a small boy standing next to him, otherwise you would get a good idea of how big or how small it really was. But nevertheless, it was the beginning of an experiment which went on. Now this good-looking chap, I suppose I was his successor in running the company of Merton Pell, so I don't share anything in there in looks. But he was brought to England by his father. They came out of Germany when the draft appeared there. And he was interested in electricity in a commercial sense. His father became the director of Nesco, who I mentioned in my notes, the Newcastle Electric Supply Company, later to become the Northeast Electric Supply. At this point, I should just add that he had some relatives and friends who were very influential. Now, those of you who've been to Newcastle and have studied the place, it's hemmed in on two sides, and it's really a bit of a village. The city itself is, you have to travel 100 miles in any direction, including the North Sea, to get anything of its size. So there is a kind of isolation, but that has benefits in that this man here, although he went to the university to read electrical engineering, in fact, the same one as I did, but he walked out after the first year because he found it boring. He wanted to get into things that were made and made to work. His aunt was an inventor in her own right. He had two uncles, one who was very senior in Newcastle business and had interest in the coal mining industry, not surprisingly, and another uncle who owned the biggest shipyard in Britain at the time. And he was influential. Listening to this man and explaining that what he wanted was a new form of power, electricity to drive his machine tools and his huge shipyard under a tunnel. So you see that with what you need is family and friends to get on, not several degrees from local university. I mentioned Mertz and McLeod and Company, the consulting engineers, but Mertz started it, and I mentioned the fact that he had a partner called William McLeod, who was the complete opposite in terms of type of person. He was purely technical. He was extremely shy, never married. Mertz, on the other hand, was a good-looking guy, very outgoing, well connected with his family. And the two were the perfect match for each other. The reason he's dressed there in the uniform of, anybody spot the uniform of which regiment? It's the Royal Marines, actually, because during World War One, he left the industry and power supply for utilities and so on for 2 or 3 years and became an advisor in electricity use on ships and in early forms of detection. That's why he wore a military uniform, that's what he did for people, as opposed to giving them more money. Now, there's Charles Mertz on the extreme right, a young man then of 25 years of age. He started a consulting engineering company purely in power, purely in electricity, the supply of it, the generation of it, and the transmission of it. The first two years after his first power station was commissioned, on next to the wall of the shipyard, where three-phase 400-volt electricity was fed mainly to the shipyard and neighbouring industrial plants. He was obviously seen to be so important and so advanced in his thinking to gather two of the great men of electricity, George Westinghouse and Lord Kelvin. One obviously came from the US, the other came from Scotland. They came to see what there was in this power station at Neptune Bank. Was built in 1901. None of them seemed to have learned, as a result, to smile. Not even Charles Mertz, who knew it would work. Never mind. 1901 was followed in 1904 by another power station, again developed by the same team of people and owned by UNESCO, and that was commissioned in 1904. Now that looks much more like the kind of power station you'd expect to see up to and during and even after World War One. And that Carville power station had some remarkable technical features that I'm not going to go into. They included reheating of steam. Sorry?
Surprise.
I was too. I don't think all machines are, but nevertheless. This was built on a unitized principle, so that each one was controlled itself. And you can't see the photograph, but there's a control room for the whole power station there, separately in one end, to control each machine. The important thing was that this power station effectively replaced Neptune Bank, which I showed you, because it was no longer big enough to make a useful contribution to the power system to which it was connected. And just to show you that Mertz thought very deeply about this, he realized that to get greater efficiency in the UNESCO system, lower costs, and security of supply, the load side of electricity usage should be increased as far as possible. And he included in his workforce people who were promoting the use of electricity, mainly industrial. And as a result of this, Mertz became a friend of the Northeastern Railway Company, who had a steam-hauled suburban system, and he convinced them that the way to improve the cleanliness of the trains, the speed of the trains, the acceleration of the trains, and the attractiveness of people who lived coast, back to electrify the line. It was DC. Nevertheless, after conversion, went back as a demand on the system, and that gave Mertz the opportunity think in terms of bigger generators, better generators, more efficient, and therefore cheaper electricity. And that was electrified in 1904. People used to get on with things in those days. That Carville station, I think I remember on the slide later on, it shows you that it was built, designed, and built in 18 months. Can you imagine? It would take 8 years. Now, for those of you who are electrical engineers, that's a grid, because the Northeastern Electricity Supply Company spread wings. It bought out all the smaller colliery companies that produce their own electricity and heat. And, more important still, it bought out the Cleveland Company, which produced electricity on the Teesside, and connected the two together. So it was that fewer big machines needed to be connected to the system because you had this spare capacity distributed around the Northeast rail or grid. And the company became the biggest single company producing electricity in the whole of the UK. By, I shall probably refer to this, it supplied electricity from Berwick-on-Tweed in the north to about 20 miles south of Middlesbrough in the south. It was one single company, only possible because of the size of the generators and machines used, and the interconnection of the two main parts of it by a 20 kV cable, which had never seen the light of day in any power company up to that point. Now, I should just add, by the way, that at the same time as this was going on, this was about 1908, and this was a bit like this, there were 640 separate power system or power companies in the UK. So do a little bit of arithmetic and see how much bigger this one is than anything else. There were 66 companies in London alone operating, as I will touch on in a minute, operating on different voltages, different frequencies, many of them DC, none of them could be connected together. Now, when that was planned and thought of, was one thing missing, namely circuit breakers, which I've shown as X on there, you can all see that. The switchgear, there was no switchgear suitable for building a system like that. And worse still, there was no distance protection to operate the switchgear. And so it was that Charles Mertz came to London, acquainted himself with this French guy called Alphonse Rayrault. He induced him to come to Tyneside. A beautiful thought for him. He had no knowledge of electricity, but he was a wonderful craftsman. And so, he brought him to Newcastle to provide switchgear in the first instance for the diagram from the system that I just showed you. One of his best employees, one of Mertz's best employees, because already he'd been in business as a consultant for about 8 years, was this other smiling chap who was the designer of the switchgear and the distance protection system. He had a guy called Price who joined him. I don't have a picture of him. And so all the ingredients that come together at the end of the first decade of the last century in order to produce a totally interconnected local grid, and although they may not have known it at the time, all the technology was there for a national grid. And that's the first type of switchgear, called metal clad switchgear. That had to be developed and built and tested before that local network became possible. It was installed in 1909. Now, I just want to show you the main stations. I mean, Neptune Bank opened in 1901, closed in 1915, because it was too small. Carville, Dunstan, North Tees, when I was a young boy, young man, were still operational. But the important thing is, look at the size of the generators that were installed. The biggest that were economically possible, and the biggest that could be connected to a system of that type. But the size of the generators rose from about 3.5 to 20 megawatts in a very short space of time. And that all led to the economy of the system, and of course pointed the way for a grid system in the future. Just cast your eye over that. The achievements of the UNESCO pioneers. There were other people. A guy called Sloan, who was the general manager of UNESCO, he was very keen on developing all this, because if he saw the price of electricity dropping, as it did, and dropping below the level of any other company in the country, that attracted industry, and that was part of the cleverness of the whole thing. But those technical developments in a period which included World War I and took only 17 years formed the basis of power systems at that time and today. And there's a diagram of that same northeast system. It looks a bit like a grid, doesn't it? And the black dots, we don't have many of them, none of them, in fact, for the common reason. But it allowed all the industrial processes, particularly chemicals on the Teesside, and indeed on the Tyneside, they're attracted by the cheap electricity. There you have something, I think that applies to about 1909. And you can see the two subsystems, if you like. The one around Tyneside is a bit bigger, but nevertheless, it's established the principle that I've already described to you. Before I leave this, I just want to mention that in 1922, after World War I, Mertz's ideas were so futuristic, so interesting to all industries, including railways, that they actually designed and built an electric loco to run on the to be electrified main line between Newcastle and York, and then on to other lines as well. Why did it not go any further, and why was it that this engine was kept in storage and shown as a museum piece, really? The reason was that in 1923, as you probably know, the North Eastern Railway Company, which had a monopoly in the area, and therefore was one of the few profitable ones, merged with other companies, the Great Northern, the Great Eastern, North British and so on, and it was not so profitable. And the boards of those companies didn't like the idea of this electrified line. They kept their hands in their pockets. So it just became something. But again, Mertz's relationship with Sir Vincent Raymond, who was chief mechanical engineer at the time of the North Eastern Railway, it was important that it got to this part. There were electrified lines on the Quayside in Newcastle and the Sheldon line in County Durham, which was a mineral line, but on much smaller electric locomotives than that. Just to give you a little idea about the growth of the electrical power industry on the Tyneside, pay no attention to the titles in the top there. This is the test area of railroad switchgear. The test area, not the manufacturing area. Such was the amount of switchgear, and not only the design that I've shown you, but also as time went on, of switchgear with higher fault current ratings and of voltage as well. And by the way, in 1923, they had to get some new switchgear, because they upgraded that interconnected to Teesside to 66 kV, first use of that voltage in the UK. So it was true, you see, that Tyneside led the world. You didn't believe it. This is a picture in the centre of this vessel, what's called still there, or cargo house, which became the headquarters of Nesco and their collaborative consultants. When I first started the firm in 1964, I worked on the fourth floor in the building and still had those connections. It's sort of fake, you see, it's got cars from 1929 there. It sells, it doesn't work there now, it's gone back to the smaller premises as the so-called grid. It's not a grid, it's a distribution system. But it shows the size of the organization and it shows their aspirations as well. And that is the last bit of this bit of the presentation, because you saw the mention of Dunstan Power Station. Now that was the last power station that Nesco built. But it looks like a not too old power station. And when I was head of Hudson Tower, we had an office, almost opposite this, before it was dismantled. And I could look at this and just be aware of the history that had gone into this point. How many years before you have the... The sort of historical bit and why people can say that the Northeast have been the precursor to the grid. Let's push on. I show this because I mentioned earlier that there are several hundred, I think 600 odd, local utilities in England, Wales, Scotland, that they were all separate, mostly municipal in ownership, but a significant number of private power companies. And that's the most remarkable names. Most of them were giving away, as did Nesco, whereabouts of the business. But I put this up here because in 1914, it's the size and energy produced that I just wanted to get a little look at there. There was a doubling between the beginning and end of the war, as people put more isolated systems together, the energy has the same sort of ratio. I put 1926 in because that's the year when, in fact, the grid was agreed in the Electricity Act of that year. By then, it still hadn't been much of a connection. But look at 1936, when the grid was in full swing, and look at the coal consumption compared to the earlier figures. I don't want you to think that those figures all came down because they were connected to the grid. That's not the case. But it did allow much bigger generators than they could have had before, and therefore the machines were efficient and bigger. Now this one, I struggled with this slide because it's the nub of how the grid came to be. Towards the end of the war, various worthies were called upon by the Board of Trade to write reports on what they should do if that war ever ended. One thing that is missing in there is the electric light Act of 1909, which allowed smaller utilities to buy power from larger ones if they were nearby. Now, that might sound logical to you, but it wasn't allowed for many years. But an act was passed then, before the war even came about, that bigger power systems must be the nature of the future. And there were three people out at fault, Harvey Wirtz, Parsons, and a guy called Lurchenoff, produced reports system in the UK could be improved. A lot of it, because you can expect Mertz and Parsons, technical men, were increasing the size. The costs were also addressed. These were commissioned by the Board of Trade. And as a result of this, and a result of the standing that they held these people in, they went and formed yet another committee in 1918, and they were still on, the Williamson Committee, which led to the Electricity Supply Act. Unfortunately, and this is quite important in the context of the story, unfortunately, the Williamson Committee recommended basically 16 small grid systems, just like the Northeast, in which, to all intents and purposes, there was public ownership. As a result of the desire for public ownership given in the Williamson Committee, and you could see the government of the day was getting exasperated by the participants in this game. But by the time that report, which had gone through many stages, became the Electricity Supply Act of 1990, the only thing that remained of the original proposals of the Williamson Committee was the establishment of the Electricity Commissioners, who, by the time that was enforced, the Electricity Supply Act was purely advisory. Now, it seems to me that it would be worthwhile quoting some of the things that were actually written at the time. Sufficient time has elapsed and sufficient experience is available to show the defects of the original legislation. Experience has shown that the comparatively small areas of the companies and local authorities working under provisional orders, etc., in many cases is insufficient to enable the government to retain the modern improvements. And it goes on. Parochial system of generation and distribution should give place to more economical methods involving wider areas of distribution. Wouldn't apply to Nesco, but apply to everybody else. So they were left with virtually nothing that they could work with in the 1919 Act. 3 years later, there was an addendum really to that Act, which allowed money from the government to allow some of the companies who wanted to expand and interconnect a little bit with their neighbours, but it wasn't really effective. The big problem was, well, it was trying it. The local authorities who owned, let's say, 60% of the generation, didn't trust the private suppliers, and neither of trusted the government and whatever hue that this lot wouldn't be nationalised. Now you see there the whole thing ran wild and they just pressed on through 1922 Act with their own system, with minor things that were so obvious that everybody would benefit. Lloyd George was dragged out of retirement to try and speed the process up, and the only thing he came up was, well, let's get rid of all the different frequencies we have in the system, and that might help. I'll refer to that in a minute. In 1924, the aforementioned commissioners, in their annual report, said it cannot be too strongly stated that united effort and the willingness to pool resources for the common good are essentially to produce the larger results of cheapening the supply throughout electricity districts, bring about a great extension of public supplies for all purposes. The powers of control vested in commissioners by the General Acts have enabled progress to be made in securing coordinated development during the past 4 years, but it has become apparent that a real organisation which will adequately serve the requirements of the country can only be achieved on the voluntary basis of the Acts radical change in the attitude of authorising and taking in general, and then it goes on through time. You can see their frustration for achieving virtually nothing. because the Act made it voluntary. And that was the big change. You can tell also from other things that I've called here, the government was losing its patience. They set up another committee in 1975 and effectively told them what to write. Well, then they do that sort of thing. They said they wanted a national solution to the problem, and that, and of course, I've already stated that the technology was available and needed to be improved. And the WEA committee, which was set up by the Tory government, took the WEA report, which was written in double quick time and embodied in the electricity supply of 1926. In terms of reference, and review the national problem of supply electricity and present a report on broad lines of policy. The policy was already there, which could be adopted to ensure its most efficient and effective development. But the big term, the big issue that came, and I suppose people could see it, but despite all the rows in that between utilities and the government, was the setting up under the Act of Central Electricity Board, which was to be responsible both for the generation, for the erection of the grid, and for the operation of the stations. The operation of the stations, not the building. The building and owning of the stations, if they were big enough to connect to the grid, remained the property of the companies that are here. And therefore, the Act's most outstanding feature was the creation of the Central Electricity Board, and in thus providing for the central coordination of generation and main transmission of electricity. It succeeded in meeting the technical demands of the industry as no previous legislation had done. And also it was a foreteller of what happened in 1947. Right, press on. At the bottom there you see how long it took to get from passing the Act to actually having the thing in a more or less complete state. That was an early attempt by Charles Mertz to outline what the grid might look like. Now, the system he first produced in the Northeast operated at 40 hertz, as you saw, even in the title. So be careful when you look at those red lines. The grid could initially not take in the castle on time. And that slide shows you why. Let's see how many different frequencies there were in 1930 to be connected. 51%, 81% operated at 50 hertz. Not Mertz's own invention, but most of the rest. The reason why it was that 40 hertz is good, it's a good compromise for industrial three-phase motors and lighting. All the rest were mainly to do with lighting when they were established. What I should say is that, of course, by mid to late 30s, all the conversion work which had to go on by standing down the generation which was not required in the future, and also supplying new full supply points from the grid, had been carried out. So you had to have a fairly quick speed of growth of the system to do this, so that you could phase out the old stuff and bring it in, and not wait a long time while people don't know electricity. That's what the grid looked like in 1933, built it up a little bit until the Second World War. But it's by that time it was foreseen that the Northeast and Scotland, of course, would be part of it. This one shows you the price of electricity. It was very important to the government when they passed those acts that it wasn't just more efficient and more cheap power, it was the fact that they needed or wanted to supply electricity to more people in rural areas and supply potentially places where new industry could But you can see there the effects that the grid had. The first decrement in price from 249 to 176 was largely because more efficient steam turbines were coming into effect. But the next one, the earlier you go, the harder it gets, is largely because those bigger machines were connected to the national grid. There's some hard-working chaps climbing up the first tower to be built in the Commonwealth. You'll notice the workers are climbing high up, and the consulting engineers hangers on standing around waiting for their lunch. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've learned something of where the grid came from, why it was time-sized. I haven't explained why we're a large football team. I hope you will accept what I've told you is the truth. That grid, as I showed there, stood us in good stead for the next conflict. But again, there had to be changes. And that worry or dream that some people might have had of having the whole system under government control, of course, came to pass in 1947. It took a long time, but that's what happened. And then we all laid it over 275 kV, 400 kV. Now, one day, we connect Hinkley Point to it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I think I'll give everyone.